people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. So finally, after months of a bitter standoff, the tanks and troops at LAC in India's Ladakh region are retracting. Both India and China, after several rounds of diplomatic and military talks, have called it peace along the Pangong Lake. Talks are underway to also disengage from the other points of confrontation. While Chinese Army PLA, which has been accused of bullying its neighbors, failed in browbeating its Indian counterparts. Beijing's trade and diplomatic defeats, coupled with bad press, have compelled it to withdraw from high altitudes where its intrusive campaigns have only proven to be futile and counterproductive.
This video released by Indian Army shows a systematic disengagement being carried out by Chinese PLA and Indian Army in the barren mountains of Ladakh, where the Pangong Lake is located. The breakthrough was achieved after 10 months of a bitter standoff that had escalated to a primitive-style fistfight between two sides in June, killing 20 Indian soldiers and an unspecified number of Chinese troops. As per the agreement, the Chinese troops who had intruded to the Indian side of LAC at Finger 4 are to retreat to east of Finger 8. Indian troops will be based at their permanent base near Finger 3. New Delhi's endeavours have been to promote and restore peace and tranquility at the border, and it followed a sustained exercise of dialogue to reach the agreement.
Sabhapati Mohode, friction kshetron mein disengagement ke liye Bharat ka yeh mat hai ki 2020 ki forward deployments jo ek dusre ke bahut nazdeek hain ve dur ho jaye aur dono senaen wapas apni apni sthayi jo manne chaukiyon par wapas lauti.
Several international observers who have closely followed the Chinese expansionist designs in the past say that people might call it a mutual agreement, but Beijing has suffered a defeat of a sort as India did not cow down even to its intense pressure and in fact gave it back whenever China transgressed. And it was after Beijing realized that India, unlike other small and less powerful nations, will not back down until they alter their bullish stance. India has mobilized thousands of troops and heavy artillery in the region, realizing diabolic geopolitical ambitions of China. It also carried out a series of missile tests to keep itself prepared for further escalation. Defence Minister Rajnath Singh, while addressing his parliament members, said that not an inch of the territory was conceded to Chinese.
बातचीत के लिए हमारी स्ट्रेटजी तथा अप्रोच माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी के इस दिशा निर्देश पर आधारित है कि हम अपनी एक इंच जमीन भी किसी और को नहीं लेने देंगे. हमारे दृढ़ संकल्प का ही यह फल है.
Last year, China had stepped up its intrusive exercise in a bid to divert the global attention following the outbreak of the deadly pandemic, which had its root back in the Chinese mainland. However, India's swift response, both militarily and diplomatically, foiled its plans. New Delhi also banned a number of Chinese applications, rendering its private players who have been in cahoots with the government a major financial blow. Beijing also registered a trade loss following a section of Indian market boycotted Chinese products. Relocation of businesses out of China owing to alleged Chinese complicity in the spread of the coronavirus added to the woes. China has also been rattled by the applause India has received following its expeditious supply of safe and effective COVID vaccines across the continents. So past 1 year has just been of defeats, and that too of colossal defeats for Chinese. On the other side, India has shown the world it has not just been advocating peace and harmony, but has been walking the talk whenever there was a need to. In such a pro-India global sentiment and scenario coupled with assertive and equipped Indian forces, China didn't have many options available. It had to backtrack, and it did.
Moving on, the Nepal political crisis is getting murkier. In what is already appearing to be a prolonged crisis, both factions of PM Oli and opposition leader Pushpa Kamal Dahal are battling it out on the streets. While the Supreme Court is yet to pronounce its assessment and ruling, the leaders have stepped up their blame game. PM Oli, who has been expelled from his party, has very conveniently returned to his nationalistic rhetoric to regain what observers have dubbed lost support. The opposition, meanwhile, has vowed to intensify its movement until what they say, justice is served and parliament is restored.
The politics of Himalayan nation Nepal is in doldrums. A large section of country's citizenry has taken sides and is on the streets rooting for its leader's stand and demand. Incidents of clashes and violence that were foreseen by observers weeks ago are now increasingly occupying space amidst demonstrations. Opposition, which has escalated its demand of reinstating the parliamentary functions, has garnered more support of late. Tens of thousands have added since the lower house of the Nepalese parliament was dissolved by Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli on 20th December. The men at the helm of the swelling opposition, Pushp Kamal Dahal, who goes by his nam de guerre Prachanda, has even warned of a revolt if what he calls the unconstitutional move was not rolled back.
यदि संविधान को अक्षर र भावना संविधान को मर्म र भावना विपरीत नेपाली जनता को चाहना र आकांक्षा विपरीत केही काम गरियो भने त्यो दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण हुनेछ त्यो नेपाली जनतालाई सही हुने छैन जनता को यो शान्तिपूर्ण आन्दोलन विद्रोहमा गयो भने के हुन्छ प्रत्येकले विचार गर्न जरुरी छ
Meanwhile, K.P. Sharma Oli, now the caretaker Prime Minister, who has already announced date of the snap elections in April and May, has launched scathing attacks on opposition, saying they never let him work and wanted to topple his government. Since this dissolution, Oli has been in a campaigning mode, asking people to back him in the upcoming elections. He has resorted to nationalistic rhetoric, asking people to unite against the force which he accuses of harming the sovereignty of the country. Opposition has dismissed it as desperation.
Thank you.
even ruled out the role of the Supreme Court in current crisis, saying it was a political issue and judiciary had no role and authority to intervene. However, the petitions have been thoroughly observed by the judiciary and it is set to give its verdict in coming days. While an Oli victory would push country towards elections on 30th April and 10th May, a different ruling could bring his political ambitions to an end. Now, much remains uncertain in the country that has witnessed different coups and disorders in governance. 2015 constitution was supposed to provide it immunity against such situation, but even that has failed. Country's economy has already been battered by the pandemic and a political crisis has only worsened the situation. And while observers across the world are closely monitoring the rapidly evolving dynamics of Kathmandu, the country might be pushing itself into deeper trouble where it would be no less than an uphill task to recover from even after the crisis is over.
Moving on. In the line of Indo-Afghan Development Partnership, New Delhi and Kabul recently signed a memorandum of understanding to build a dam in Kabul province to meet the drinking water and irrigation needs of people of the region. The event held just 3 days after Kabul received India-manufactured COVID vaccines further emphasized at Indo-Afghan ties that are marked by years of assistance, cooperation and joint endeavors towards attaining all-round peace.
New Delhi has pledged $236 million for a dam construction in Afghanistan. This is the latest in the wide array of development projects India has built for the war-torn country. The Shatur Dam construction is a part of the series of new development initiatives announced by India in November last year. Apart from the dam construction, New Delhi will also be spearheading 150 community projects worth $80 million in the country. The Shatur Dam will be a source of drinkable water for 2.2 million people of Kabul and also provide irrigation facilities for 4,000 hectares of land. Prime Minister Narendra Modi exuded confidence in the ever-strengthening partnership with Afghanistan, where people have increasingly suffered violence and political crisis.
मैं ये कह सकता हूँ कि आज हम काबुल में जिस सहतूत बांध के निर्माण पर समझौता कर रहे हैं, उसकी नींव सिर्फ ईंटों और मोर्टार पर नहीं बनेगी, बल्कि भारत अफगान दोस्ती की ताकत पर टिकी होगी।
While Afghanistan has been dubbed and exploited as a strategic landmass by observers and countries over the years, India has supported its peace endeavors through development initiatives. Over the years, India has completed more than 400 projects in all 34 provinces of Afghanistan, and its pledges totaling $3 billion make it the largest donor in the region. Not just this, India shipped 75,000 tons of wheat as an aid to Afghanistan via Iran's Chabahar port, the connectivity point that will be used vigorously in coming times. Afghanistan, which has suffered severely due to pandemic owing to its weak health system, also received 500,000 of India-manufactured Covishield vaccine this week. New Delhi says Afghanistan is its close partner and it will never shy away from assisting it in times of crisis.
Chahe dawaiyan aur PPE ho ya Bharat mein bani vaccine ki supply हमारे लिए अफगानिस्तान की आवश्यकताएं हमेशा महत्वपूर्ण रही है और रहेगी।
Your decision to provide us with 500,000 doses of the vaccine at this critical time when Indians themselves are looking for every single vaccine could not be a greater gift. These doses will be administered to our frontline health workers, our heroic security forces, and vulnerable people. We cherish this act of exceptional generosity.
India has provided shelter to thousands of Afghans who fled violence back at home. While many travel to India for treatment and trade, many others have temporarily settled in India. New Delhi, they say, is their second home. The story just doesn't end here. While several others, including China and Pakistan, have been making sustained efforts to increase their clout in the country, it is India helping Afghans silently, improving their lives and endeavoring to bring peace in their country and lives.
The illegally occupied region of POK is grappling with inflation. The cost of almost all items has skyrocketed. The wheat flour price has especially gone up, with people not being able to purchase enough flour even for a square meal a day. People are struggling to fulfill their basic needs with the income they earn through their menial jobs, but government doesn't seem to pay any heed. A report.
People in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir have been severely hit by an unprecedented inflation. While services and commodities across Pakistani jurisdiction have become exorbitant, it is particularly the financial insecure residents of POK who are bearing the brunt. Their lives are in dire straits, for they do not know how they will sustain once their limited resources to procure everyday essentials run out. They accuse the government of betraying them. The Imran Khan administration, which is the real controller of the region, promised them allowances but never ensured it.
Aap hi bataye ki bhai ek 80 saal ka pura aadmi wo apni family ka kaise guzar karta hoga, kya hai? Imran sahab ne kaha ki bhai 12,000 hum dete hain, sabko dete hain. Hamare to hame ye pata nahi kisi ko mile hain ya nahi mile, jabki hamari family mein hamare किसी को कुछ भी नहीं मिला है। तो इस तरह वादे बहुत करते हैं, लेकिन अल्लाह हिदायत दे उन लीडरों को कि वो आवाम के साथ भी कोई सच्चाई करें। मैं कहता हूँ कि इमरान खान ने जो कुछ बोला था, जो किया था, उसमें 10% भी आवाम को कुछ नहीं मिला है।
While Islamabad's economic policies that are actually framed in the country's army headquarters have pushed millions towards poverty, its failure in containing the petroleum prices are now hurting them even more. From kitchen staples to transportation, almost everything has become costlier by a substantial margin. And with the employment rate recording a historic plunge in the last 12 months, even a square meal a day is considered lucky and luxurious by the people. And with no tangible government efforts, no assistance in the pipeline, the future of these hapless citizens is only appearing bleak.
Har aadmi is baat ko janta hai ki is daur mein mehngai jo hai wo uruj pe pahunch chuki hai, cheeze aasman se baatein kar rahi hain, aur batore khaas petroleum masnua ye din ba din badh rahi hain, mahis mahine mein taqreeban do martaba inki prices jo hain wo badhi hain. तो जाहिर है कि जब पेट्रोलियम मसनूआत बढ़ती हैं तो तमाम चीज़ों पर इसका असर होता है, वो ट्रांसपोर्ट हो, दीगर ज़राए नकल हरकत हो, तो इस पर असर पड़ता है।
Ever since Pakistan occupied this region in October 1947 through its mercenaries, it has deprived the people of the region their rights and honor. It has ensured through both its legislative policies and security barriers that people in the illegally occupied Kashmir do not attain a certain living standard. It wants them to struggle for every single morsel. With no financial security and nothing in the store, one can only see a looming disaster of destitution and deaths for these men and women who literally have no one to look forward to in the state-manufactured crisis.
One of the most unique features of India is its rivers, and they also hold high religious significance among the people. They are considered as god and goddesses in the country and are worshipped by Hindus. Every year, a number of festivals and rituals are also held in the holy river Ganga. One such ritual is Mauni Amavasya. So today, we will take you to India's temple towns where devotees took a holy dip to mark the auspicious day of Mauni Amavasya. Let's have a look.
Thousands of Hindu devotees took holy dips and offered prayers to mark the occasion of Mauni Amavasya or No Moon Day amid the coronavirus pandemic. It marks the beginning of Shukla Paksh or the bright fortnight of the lunar month. It is derived from the word Muni, which literally means an ascetic who practices absolute silence. However, this day is also believed to be the birth of Manu Rishi, due to which this day is celebrated as Mauni Amavasya. As per the Hindu almanac, Mauni Amavasya is considered the most important and auspicious day.
सभी श्रद्धालुगण जो है बहुत श्रद्धा भक्ति से मौनी स्नान कर रहे हैं वस्तुतः यहां पर कोरोना काल चल रहा है और बहुत सारे डर है लेकिन फिर भी इस आस्था के सामने ये कोरोना जो बीमारी है वो फीकी पड़ गई है
On this day, people perform rituals for the salvation of their ancestors and give donations to priest or needy. It is believed that the water of the holy river Ganges turns into nectar on Mauni Amavasya.
आज मौनी अमावस्या है और आज के दिन में मौन होकर स्नान किया जाता है और आज के दिन में कुंभ का मेला भी लगता है 12 साल पर इलाहाबाद में मेन नहान कुंभ मौनी अमावस्या का इलाहाबाद में होता है और मौनी अमावस्या का नहान जो है मौन होके किया जाता है और दान दक्षिणा किया जाता है यथाशक्ति जिसकी जो शक्ति होती है
Such rituals in Hinduism portray the rich cultural history where faith can part a river, move mountains and endure the hardships. It is a set of shared attitudes, values, goals and practices which symbolizes the plurality of its Indian culture.
The Government of India has also been working extensively to rejuvenate and revive various rivers so that this culture can thrive. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.